Glückwunsch.
Yes, thank you once again. Yeah, my topic is Transcaval. It's another of these new techniques, and we started with this four years ago in Munich, and also we started with Lampoon and with Basilica 2 years ago. I have the same opinion. Lampoon and Basilica at the current time, it's not, you cannot offer every patient, so perhaps the younger patients, and you have no other options, it's not for everybody. But Basilica will become a proctored, proctored support in the US, so it will change and it will be more standardized in the future, I think. So we do proctoring for transcaval in the US now for 2 years. So it became a common technique. A lot of hospitals now use it as an alternative access when the femoral access is not possible. So let's look what options we have. You all know this. We as interventional cardiology, we do only transfemoral puncture. But with 14 franchises nowadays, we can have a safe access in more than 95% of our patients, especially in Germany. People are taller, have bigger vessels perhaps. But we know as alternative to transfemoral, the other options, transapical and transaortic techniques, they have not as good results. And I want to show you transcaval as an alternative, also transfemoral access. It's transfemoral venous access with crossing towards the aorta in height of the descending aorta. So how does the technique work? Here it is in a publication from Adam Greenbaum, who did the first cases in Detroit, and you place a snare as a target in a by CT predicted place, and then you puncture from the vena cava towards the aorta. So then you place your wire and you place your catheter and you do your implant, and afterwards you place it, you close it with a plug. So easy it is. Why it works? Because you have to know the pressure in the retroperitoneum is higher than in the vena cava. When you make a hole in a vena cava, usually nothing happens. You don't get a retroperitoneal bleeding. When you make a hole in aorta only, you get a big retroperitoneal bleeding, so that's not a good idea. When you do make two holes next to each other, what happens? You create a shunt. And this is dangerous, but not as dangerous than bleeding. What is the danger for the patient is that the right ventricle will get an will have an overload, and yeah, so that's a risk, but it's not a bleeding. You don't lose the blood. We do the screening and the planning of the procedure also based on a CT, and in the CT we usually look for a calcium-free window in the descending aorta facing the vena cava, because we want to puncture from vena cava to the aorta, and usually it is somewhere in height of lumbar vertebra 3 or 4. That's usually you find something. It should be below the renal arteries and above the aortic bifurcation. So planning, it's not this difficult, and then when you start the procedure, we usually do a simultaneous injection in vein and in the aorta, and then we look for the crossing place that we find it based on the column vertebra. How with what do we use for crossing? We use as a guiding RDC catheter normally used for renal interventions. Inside this, we have a Navicross catheter, which has 0.35 width. And inside, a wire converter, a piggyback, and then the crossing wire. Let's start once again. Crossing wire, piggyback, which makes out of the 14 wire a 35 wire, and this inside a transit casita, here Navicross, and this inside your guiding. The wire choice, you cannot use every wire. You need a metallic wire because we put electro energy on it. It's shown here at the other side. We put electro pencil and we connect it safe that we can give energy on this metallic wire because we burn through the tissue with this CTO wire. Here is written 9, now we take the 12 wire, and what we do to make it even stiffer, we cut the distal end 1 centimeter roundabout. And then we place the gooseneck snare in the aorta as our target, that we can see it collateral in a PA view, and we place our RDC casita and prepared the wire and now piggyback and Navicross, everything is prepared. And then we go in a lateral view to target our crossing wire towards the loop of the gooseneck snare. And then we are ready to go. We give electro energy and then hopefully we cross in the right direction towards our snare. It looks simple. In 50% of cases, it's this simple. 50% of cases, it's more challenging because you don't have a good window. But in most cases, you can do this technique. And then, first the coronary wire, the wire converter, the Navicross, you put everything across this hole, what you created, the shunt you created, and then we take a stiff wire, here in this case a backup Meyer wire. You can also take a Lundquist. Over the stiff wire we place the sheath. Here it was the E-sheath, now it is axilla sheath or whatever you want. And then you, this is a more relaxing part, you do your implant. And then the second half of this procedure is then we have to close the hole. I spoke with our interventional pediatric cardiologist. He told me, don't close it. In children, we do it often, and it closed by itself. I think in elderly, it's not a good idea, so we have to close it. And this was a very early case, and in early cases, we used a VSD occluder. Now we use an ductus botali occluder. And here, to place the occluder better, we take an Agilis steerable guide to that we can navigate the direction of the occluder. Yeah, and then we place the occluder. We release the second part here. In this case, the second part is only used as an anchor. It's somewhere placed in the tissue in between vein and aorta. This is good enough. You don't have to close the vena cava hole, only the aorta hole. And this was then the final result. So around about in half of cases, you have a full occlusion then on the aortic side, as it is shown here. In the other 50%, you have a residual shunt, which is usually not very, not a lot, but you have to take care that there is not an overload of the right ventricle. When there's an overload of right ventricle, what you can do is place a balloon on the aortic side and occlude the region where the occluder is placed for 2 minutes and give them time to, because the tissue needs some time that you have a building of a thrombus, and then you can occlude it. This was the very first case, and here we did in this CT. Here, nowadays, we take the ductus botali occluder. The ductus botali occluder has more tissue, it occludes better, and what I now know, there is we wait for a special occluder for this treatment. So as I told you, in the US it became a very common treatment. For us, for me, it's not not easy to find friends for this. But perhaps here in Greece, it's it becomes common also. Hopefully, it's a good technique. You can do it also in aneurysm, and when there's a lot of thrombus at the wall, that's also it helps occlude the hole afterwards. And it was also done in a graft. So there are many options. The results here, I think they are very acceptable because, you know, these were extreme bad patients. And also, when I started, I remember the first cases we did, the patients were very bad. And for this, I think the complication rate is acceptable. And also, the one-year results were published this year, acceptable for this highest-risk patients. There's some learning curve, what is shown here. For sure, for everything new, what we do. This was our first patient. There's a little story behind this. This is Adam Greenbaum. He helped with the first case in Munich. This patient, we had a photo shooting after the treatment. Patient was lost. And he was a severe smoker. And he directly after intervention, he went out to smoke. And as I can tell you, when you close the hole in the aorta, then you have only a venous hole in a vena femoral. Patients can move very early. So that's an advantage for this treatment. Okay, that's my last slide.